Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr Eris Williams Reed. I'm a Senior Teaching Fellow in Roman History and Epigraphy in the Department of Classics and Ancient History at Warwick. And today I'm speaking to you from my home in Newcastle upon Tyne. My research interests focus on the different ways in which ancient communities interacted with the environment, particularly those communities that lived in an area that ancient historians often refer to as the Roman Near East. This is an area into which the Roman Empire gradually expanded some 2000 years ago, and it covers the modern day countries of Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, Israel-Palestine, and also parts of southern Turkey, western Iraq, and northern Saudi Arabia. Today I'm going to speak a little about a research project I've just started to work on, which is called The Year of Misery, Ecological Grief in the Safaitic Inscriptions of Ancient Northern Arabia. So what I'm going to do in this video then is to address the following questions. Firstly, what do I mean when I say Safaitic inscriptions? Namely, where do we find these texts in both time and space? By whom were they written? And what do these texts tell us about the ancient communities who wrote them? And in particular, how did these communities interact with the environment? Number two, what is meant by the term ecological grief? And how and why does it manifest? And number three, can we identify ecological grief in the ancient Safaitic inscriptions of Northern Arabia? So let's turn first then to the Safaitic inscriptions. There are tens of thousands of these texts, which are now completely accessible thanks to the efforts of a major research project at Oxford University, which has led to the creation of the online corpus of inscriptions of ancient North Arabia. Safaitic is an ancient dialect with a distinctive script, an example of which we saw right at the beginning of this video, which also showed that some of these texts could be accompanied by images. The term Safaitic is a modern one, and it refers to the Safa region, which is in the modern day area of southern Syria. It's important to stress that this term denotes a script and a dialect, not an ethnic group, so we cannot speak of a Safaitic people who wrote these texts. This is not least because we find them across a large area ranging between northern Jordan and southern Syria, as well as some more remote examples even further afield. These texts are notoriously difficult to date, but it's now generally assumed that many were written between the 1st century BC and the 4th century AD. In terms of their physicality, as illustrated by the image we saw at the beginning of the video, these texts were carved directly onto rocks and rock faces found in the landscape, which in this part of the world is most commonly black basalt. And these texts largely take the form of what we might refer to as graffiti, with authors inscribing their messages however they saw fit. So what do some of these texts say, and what do they tell us about the people who wrote them? The vast majority of these texts are relatively brief and simply record the presence of the person who carved them, saying simply, for instance, by Asad, son of Abda. But many also record the author's activities, and from this we can see that the individuals who wrote these texts were nomadic pastoralists. These were people who moved through the region with their livestock in order to make the best use of available pasture at different times of the year. Thus we have texts that say, for instance, by Asa, son of Asad, and he came to water at this shallow pool, and his father sent his camels to water one by one in the year the winter brought no rain, and when Odin fled from Roman territory. This text, written by Asa, son of Asad, tells us a few interesting details about the people who wrote them. Despite being nomadic pastoralists, these are individuals who are still bound up in local politics, as the author dates this text with reference to the year when someone called Odin fled from Roman territory. Indeed, a lot of previous research has revealed how intimately linked some of these communities were to this area's political geography, and other areas indeed describe themselves as fighting in local military units. But what I'm particularly interested in is what these texts tell us about the environmental knowledge of these communities. Asa, son of Asad, also dates his text with reference to the year in which the winter brought no rain. As a result, Asa says that his father tells him to go to the shallow pool, where he then proceeds to water his camels one by one. This recording of environmental knowledge is a major theme across these texts, something that isn't surprising given the activities of those who wrote them. The environment in which we find these texts was one of a very delicate balance. Nomadic communities would enter the steppe during the winter, when they would make use of limited winter rainfall, and then in the summer they would return towards lusher agricultural areas where rainfall was higher and more stable. As a result, and this is something that comes across very clearly in these texts, these communities knew precisely where to find water and suitable pasture at different times of the year. But as we'll return to at the end of this video, there were instances when the environment did not behave how these people expected it would do, something with which many contemporary communities have become familiar with in recent years. What I'm going to do now, though, is turn to my second question. What is ecological grief? Although we might be quite familiar now with the term eco-anxiety due to its increasing popularity in the media, the notion of ecological grief has a longer history. For over several decades, many scholars working in the sciences and social sciences have been exploring the potential for individuals and communities to experience emotional pain when they endure environmental loss. In the past 10 years, research has demonstrated that global environmental change can have a negative impact on the mental health of affected individuals and communities. Specifically, some scholars have framed this impact as ecological grief, with Ashley Consolo and Neville R. Ellis defining this concept in a 2018 article as, and I quote, "the grief felt in relation to experienced or anticipated ecological losses, including the loss of species, ecosystems, and meaningful landscapes due to acute or chronic environmental change." In particular, research has shown that negative impacts are found most strongly in those who have very close living, working, or indeed cultural relationships to particular landscapes. And this is precisely because a loss of environmental knowledge as a result of ecological change can then trigger grief. For example, interviews conducted with members of the Inuit community at Nun Atsiavut revealed that people experienced distress at the thought of not being able to teach their grandchildren about how to move safely through the local landscape, precisely because it had changed so much in recent years. Similarly, interviews conducted by Consolo and Ellis in the Australian wheat belt recorded the daily anxiety experienced by farmers who waited to see if their farms would be destroyed by increasingly destructive dust storms. In short, then, ecological grief recognises that the results of environmental change can lead to a negative impact on the mental health of affected individuals and communities. So what I want us to do now then is to return to the Safaitic inscriptions and consider the third and final question that I posed at the start of this video. Can we identify ecological grief in these ancient texts? The example I gave, written by Assar, son of Assad, certainly revealed that the individuals who wrote these texts did encounter environmental change, and also that knowledge of how to manage different environments was passed down through generations. But the corpus of Safaitic inscriptions also contains texts that demonstrate these communities experienced environmental loss, and in some cases, grief as a result, or at least what we might define as grief. One individual records an especially evocative testimony of how he, and I quote here, "fed the goats on dry fodder in the year of misery because Baal Shemin, the local storm god, withheld the rain." What we have here then is, unsurprisingly, an emotionally charged reaction to ecological change. The author of this text refers to the entire season as the year of misery, on account of the distress experienced as a result of lower than anticipated rainfall. Moreover, this change is framed with reference to the religious sphere, as the author claims that the rainfall has been withheld by Baal Shemin, the local storm god. This storm god also had a major sanctuary in this area, and other Safaitic inscriptions suggest that these nomadic pastoralists would undertake a pilgrimage to the sanctuary every year as part of their annual return from the steppe. The perceived failure of this pilgrimage is also mentioned in a number of Safaitic inscriptions. For instance, one text written by a certain Daba records that he waited for the rains, but the water did not come the year the gods left Seir. And this is the place where the storm god's sanctuary was located. What we have here then, I think, in these inscriptions are emotional reflections on the impact of environmental change and its resulting loss, which I think we can recognise as ecological grief. These texts bear witness to the experiences of real individuals who were anxiously waiting for the rainfall to which they had had access to at a particular time and place for many years. Individuals who are lamenting the absence of the pasture land that they expected would be there for their animals to graze on. And individuals who, in the face of environmental loss, assumed that their gods had abandoned them and no longer listened to their requests. By examining these texts with reference to the concept of ecological grief, I think we can get one step closer to recognising and appreciating the precarious, volatile, and fragile relationships that some people of the ancient world had with their local environment, a relationship to which we are all becoming increasingly attuned in the modern world. Thank you.